We are happy today to invite Professor Luigi Cartaguzano from the University of Perugia, Department of Chemistry, Biology, and Biotechnology at Italy. Professor Luigi is an expert of MD for ion channel. So he did many works about ion channel, and he and I are collaborating also on the KCSA's ion channel. So I learned a lot of MD knowledge from him. He's going to talk about the topic is a method for building microstate models of ion channel permeation from molecular dynamics data. Let's welcome him.
Okay, thank you. So I am a biologist, so and I'm going to talk about ion channels. So if you are not used, you can just ask, interrupt me where you want. Okay. So the this talk is deal with a microstate model of ion channel permeation. And we were particularly interested in a model that was able to predict a correct ionic current, because actually there are some microstate model of ion permeation, but they are not able to quantitatively predict this this variable. That is particularly important because it's the experimental observable for ion channel permeation, is what experimenter can get from ion channel. So so you know that now there are many the possibility to get ion atomic structure, atomic three-dimensional structure for all proteins, and so also for ion channel. And one might use this atomic structure to simulate the dynamics of a protein using molecular dynamics. So what does molecular dynamics is to apply Newton's law to every atom in the system, and the system will consist of our ion channel, but also lipids that are of the plasma membrane, and also water and ions. So all the system have about something like 100,000 atoms, and you might be able to let these atoms move with molecular dynamic, given a force field that has a strong bond, but also weak interactions, such as van der Waal and electrostatic interaction. So in ion channel permeation, this is important because we might get the ions trajectories to the channel during time. And so we might study the way, the mechanism through which ions pass the channel. And this is what is ion permeation, an ion channel. So the problem is that there are two main limitations with molecular dynamics. The first limitation is a time scale gap between the time that might be reached with molecular dynamics and the biologically relevant time scale, because molecular dynamics needs to use time steps of 1-2 femtoseconds. But actually, the time scale that is of interest in conformational changes or ion permeation are in the, let's say, microsecond, millisecond scale. So there is a too large gap. And the currently available computational power is not so big. So it is very hard to obtain information at this time scale by starting from femtosecond time steps. There is then a second limitation. This is due to the fact that the molecular dynamics gives you out the trajectory, the three-dimensional trajectory for every atom. So this means thousands and thousands of numbers. So we need to get an information about the mechanism of ion permeation from all this data. And likely, among all this data, only few of them are really relevant to the mechanism under study. So we need to find a way to reduce all this big quantity of data to few numbers that will tell you exactly what is the mechanism of permeation. And this is another limitation regarding complexity of the output. So and people are applying not only in ion channel permeation, but also in many problems dealing with the molecular dynamics of proteins, are applying the reduction of the system using Markov state models. So Markov state models, you probably know more than me about Markov state models. They are models in which your system can exist only in relatively few microstates, okay? So you start from molecular dynamics data that are almost continuous. They are not exactly continuous because they are each 2 femtoseconds, let's say. And so you can recognize using a sort of input features, you can recognize the existence of more different microstates in your system. So you are able to pass to a microstates clustering of your trajectory. But usually these microstates are even them too many. We are talking about thousands of possible microstates. So we need to do a successive lumping of microstates into macrostates that are so few to be useful to understand the mechanism in terms of few movements of ions inside the pore, along the pore. So you sometimes people in especially chemists are used to see these Markov models in terms of kinetic schemes. So you have different microstates connected between arrows that indicate that the system might go from one microstate to another microstate, and close to the arrow there are numbers that might be either the probability that the system go from one microstate to another microstate, or the kinetic rate constant, meaning the rate in terms of number of transitions per unit time. So we might collect all this number, that is the transition probability, the probability of going from I to J, given that the system is in I at time zero, and looking delta t after delta t at time of delta t. This delta t is called the lag time, okay? And all these numbers might build a transition probability number that has the dimension of the number of microscales. So we can go from every possible microscale to every possible microstate. So this is a square matrix. We can also describe a Markov state model using the Q matrix whose elements are the transition probabilities of going from one state to another state. Transition probabilities are defined using this relationship are related to the kinetic rate constants. So the kinetic rate constant is the limit for delta t going to zero of the transition probability for that transition at a certain lifetime divided by the lifetime. And there is an exact relationship between these two matrices that is an exponential matrix operation. And a model like this might be defined fully Markovian when the Kolmogorov Chapman equation, this one, is respected. This equation, P here is the vector, collecting the steady state occupancy of each possible state. And so we might predict the occupancy at a certain time by simply knowing the situation of the system at the previous time step by multiplying the vector of probability occupancy by the transition probability matrix. The system, people say, has no memory of the past, because you can might predict what happened in the future just if you know the situation at the actual moment. Our objective was to build the Markov state model of ion permeation. As I told you, we were particularly interested in predicting correctly and quantitatively the ionic current that goes through the channel, because usually people working with the molecular dynamics and interested in permeation, they need to compare with experiments, and the experiments are currents, that are currents of ions going through the pore. So to do this, we considered here we will consider a particular ion channel, but this is a general theory for all kind of ion channel. Our ion channel is the first one for which the structure has been obtained more than 20 years ago. It's the KCSA channel. It's a bacterial channel. It's very simple. It is formed, it is formed by four different subunits. Here are represented by the four different colors. Each subunit is embedded in a lipid plasma membrane. And so the four subunits form surround a pore where ion can go through. Okay? Here are represented only two of the four subunits. And this allows the visualization of the pore. This is the pore where ions go through. So the pore is formed by a wide intracellular vestibule. Here ions can enter inside this vestibule hydrated. So they interact with the water molecule that stabilize the ion. But once the ion needs to enter here in this second part of the pore, the selectivity filter, they need to lose water and to substitute their water interaction with the interaction with these carbonyl oxygens here that are of the protein skeleton. And why this? Because ion channel needs to be selective, and the selectivity is actually a mechanism implying that ions might be recognized, chemically recognized. So the ion needs to interact with the protein to be selected, so that potassium might be discriminated from sodium or other ions. This is the selectivity filter is the most important part of the pore. And as you can see, the selectivity filter, you can see it better here, is formed by a sequence of several amino acids, all exposing their carbonyl towards the center of the pore. So these red are carbonyl oxygens that are exposed towards the pore. Now, carbonyl oxygen have a partial negative charge because the oxygen is electronegative. It attracts electrons. So you have these negative charges that form binding sites for potassium. Potassium is positively charged, so it stays very well. In other terms, this oxygen substitutes the water oxygens in solution. And actually, people recognized using crystallography and visualizing the selectivity filter, recognized that inside the selectivity filter, I don't know why it's there are four ion binding sites. Each binding site is surrounded by eight different oxygens. So it is they are a cage of eight oxygens with at the center a positive potassium ions that is stabilized. So potassium ions, to go through the selectivity filter, it jumps between different binding sites, going from one site to another. And people also recognize two external binding sites, S0 and S5, where the ion approaches the filter, and they are partially dehydrated. They interact, begin to interact with this oxygen, but they are also hydrated. Okay, so they are in an intermediate condition in this binding sites. So in order, in terms of possible microstates, we can imagine this system where each of these binding sites might be occupied by potassium ion, might be occupied by water, because also water can enter the selectivity filter, might be occupied by both, because these binding sites actually have also the possibility to be filled by water and ions at the same time. And they might also be empty. So we have four different possibilities for each site. So we have at the end 4 to the 6 possible microstates that can define our system of permeation, that are all the possibility among these six of occupancy among these six ions. So we decided to call each microstate as a sequence of six letters, each one might vary between K, W, B, and 0, meaning the presence of potassium, the presence of water, the presence of both potassium and water, or being empty. And so in our system, the transition matrix is a matrix having dimension 4096 times 4096, that are the possible microstates. Now, how to fill this matrix? So this might be filled by computing a long molecular dynamic simulation, sometimes also microseconds of computation. And you pass along all the trajectory by jumping by a certain lag time, delta t, and each time you ask to your program to see in which configuration is present your selectivity filter. So you collect many different sequential configuration, and you count them, and each transition probability matrix is defined as the number of transition from I to J divided the number of all possible transitions starting from I. Okay, so we might fill all these matrix by using this criterion and going through our simulation trajectory. So we have in this way a transition matrix, but this is not enough. This actually, in many Markov models of proteins where protein dynamics is studied, the transition matrix is all we need to define a Markov state model. It's sufficient to define a Markov state model. In ion channel permeation, this is not true, because we are interested in current, and the transition matrix does not take information, does not have information about the charge transport, the charge transported by each possible transition. For this reason, we propose to define another matrix that we call the flux matrix, where there is the information about the charge transported. Okay, so for example, this is an example. If you go from this configuration, where potassium ions are at the S5, S3, and S2 position, and you go to this configuration where potassium are at S4, S3, and S5 position, so you need to move two potassium ions at the adjacent site more extracellular. Okay? So we might define the flux associated with this transition as 2-7. Why 7? Because 7 of such movement brings a potassium from the inside to the outside. So in this case, we have moved only 2-7 of the one full charge. Okay? And using this criterion, you might define all the flux matrix. Now there is a problem. The problem is that as it is shown here, you might go from one configuration to another in many different possible ways. Okay, the same example. You see here is the flux is 2-7, but you might also imagine other kind of movements where ions get from the inside or from the outside and giving a different flux. Okay. So which of these we might choose? So we decided to choose the flux associated with the minimum number of steps. Okay, in this case is this one, because here you involve only two steps of movement. Here you have it four, and also here you have it four. So in this case it will be 2-7. If you define the flux matrix in this way, then you can apply this equation to predict the current. So the current is given by summing the rate constant multiplied by the flux carried by that transition multiplied by the occupancy of the initial state I, and this over all the possible states. We verify that this equation recovers exactly the current also predicted by molecular dynamics, for example. Now, from this equation, you might go to another more useful equation where we substitute the Q matrix by the transition matrix, and of course we divide by delta T. But given that this definition is valid only for delta t going to zero, this means that this new equation that is more useful for us, but it can be applied only for a small lag time, but not for large lag time. Okay. So now we have a Markov state model, but this is a Markov state model very big with the 4096 microstates. So we need to lump together microstate to form fewer states. And we can do this by applying the so-called probability flux conservation to the transition to lump together states. So if we want to lump together states A and B, AB into a state X, we can apply the probability flux conservation to the transition matrix, and we can apply the charge flux conservation to the flux matrix, and we will obtain reduced transition and flux matrices, so that the same a similar equation can apply to predict the current. So and we might perform this lumping a number of times we want. Okay, so we might reduce also to very few states by lumping together states using this procedure. And now we have a Markov model, but only at the smallest possible lag time. because we said that our flux matrix is valid only for a small lag time. But now there is a problem with this, because it has been found that Markov state models coming from molecular dynamics are not Markovian, not fully Markovian, for small lag time. And they become Markovian only when the lag time is a little bit larger, okay? Usually this is the test that it is usually performed on molecular dynamic data to understand if we have full Markovianity, because it has been demonstrated by mathematicians that when the characteristic time scales of our matrix defined in this way as the lag time divided by the eigenvalue becomes independent of the lag time constant at various lag time, then the system is Markovian. So in this particular case, you see that to get a Markovian system, you need to go to, let's say, 2 or 3 nanoseconds lag time. But for shorter lag times, you don't have Markovianity. Now, this is a problem for us because we have a flux matrix that is valid only for short lag times. So we have to find an equation that find a combined matrix to be applied, a combined flux matrix to be applied for higher lag time. And actually, we found two different reasoning methods to obtain this matrix. The first one applied the charge flux conservation in time, okay, saying that the charge flux defined as the flux times the probability conserves in time, okay. And so with this equation, we might apply in a recursive way this equation to obtain the flux matrix at whatever lag time. Or otherwise, we might use this other equation that find a sort of mean of fluxes for all the possible pathways weighted for their probability of occurrence. So these two methods gives the same flux matrix, and this flux matrix can be used together with its reduced transition matrix at whatever lag time to predict this time a correct current. So we are not anymore limited to a small lag time. So the last step is to go from the transition matrix to the Q matrix of rate constants. But we might perform this by taking into account this relationship between the transition and the Q matrix. So we might minimize this function and to find the rate constants that are inside here. So through a minimization procedure, given a certain transition matrix, we can get our Q matrix if we like to have it a Q matrix. And then we can apply the usual equation to predict the current using this reduced Q matrix. So what is the overall algorithm that we propose? We start from molecular dynamic data and assess the transition matrix at varying lag times. And we also assess the minimum step flux matrix. With these two information, we can reduce our model to a very small number of states. Then we can test our reduced model for Markovianity and find the lag time that guarantee Markovianity. We can find the combined flux matrix at that lag time. And finally, we can also find the Q matrix. So we have a fully Markovian Markov model that correctly predicts the current. So we try this system on data in collaboration with another Italian, Simone Furini, We performed a simulation of the KCSA channel. Actually, it was 30 microseconds of simulation at 200 millivolts of applied potential, because of course the current will depend on the applied electric field through the membrane. And we were able to obtain, using this simulation, 330 events of conduction. And so we analyzed these events using this system. So actually, you can see from this occupancy plot that actually of the 4,096 states, only 122 were actually present in the simulation, because of course not all possible states are meaningful from a physical point of view. So we only have 122 microstates, and you can also see that the most represented are actually all states that where the central binding sites are occupied by potassium, are always occupied by potassium, while the potassium might bind and unbind to the external binding sites. You see here. Now, starting from this model, we applied the first reduction by trying to eliminate water, because we are not interested in water. So we combine together a configuration where the same site was filled by potassium or by both potassium and water, because this, from a point of view, electrophysiological point of view, these two states are equal, because they present the potassium in the same place. And similarly, we lumped together states where a binding sites were empty, was empty, or contained water. Okay, and so we called these two combined states K and O, state meaning full or empty of potassium. And so in this way, we were able to obtain 27 states. So it was a big reduction. And as before, the more represented state are those with the central binding site field. Finally, we apply another reduction method, looking at the ratio of the probability of going from I to J to the probability of going from J to I. When this ratio is very big or very small, this means that the transition is almost irreversible. And so we might combine the two states. So we use a threshold of 13. There is a reason for this, at 13 to combine the two states. So we combine all the states where this ratio was over 13. Okay, why 13? Because this 13 was the number that allow us to reduce our model to only four states. And actually, this same model, we obtained this same model together with Allen a few years ago, using a totally different consideration from molecular dynamics, also from continuous modeling, using a totally different consideration. So we believe that this model is quite meaningful. At that time, we gave to this model the name of association-dissociation model. Why this? Because you can see that permeation can occur or by first binding to the internal potassium and then unbinding to the external one, or inversely, you can unbind the external potassium and bind the internal one. Okay, so association, dissociation, or the reverse. Of course, for the permeation to be continuous, you need to a conversion between the three potassium ion configuration back and forward in a single file movement, and also this transition is a possible transition. So we recovered for this model. Here you can see the various combination of states. For this model, we recovered our reduced transition matrix and reduced flux matrix, at the shortest lag time we had, 10 picoseconds. Then we tested for Markovianity our system. And so we decided to take 10 nanoseconds to be just to be sure that Markovianity is guaranteed. And so we obtained the combined flux matrix for 10 nanoseconds. And so we, from this model, we could obtain also the rate constants, the Q matrix, using the fitting procedure that I show you. So we had in this way a full model at 200 millivolts. But usually electrophysiologists are very interested in performing the IVs, meaning assessing the current at various voltages. So we also tested the system using molecular dynamic data at varying voltages from minus 400 to plus 400 millivolt. And this showed that in all cases, we were able to obtain the same model by reducing our system. This is quite a good result. And in these plots are shown the various kinetic rate constant versus voltage, showing that they are voltage dependent. This is expected because when ions move inside the selectivity filter, voltage can favor or disfavor this movement, and so change the kinetic rate constant. And these changes were all in the sense expected. For example, here you have the single file movement from of the three ions toward the external side, and we expect that a depolarization, higher voltages, will favor the process. And indeed, we obtain an increasing rate constant. Conversely, when we analyze, for example, this is the binding of a potassium ion to a site, internal site, this will be disfavored by voltage. And in accordance, we have a decreasing function. So all this was physically meaning. And we fitted this relationship with the exponential relationship, this because there is a physical model, the Woodall model, that predicts exponential relationship of the rate constant versus voltage. And using this relationship, we were able to simulate an IV. And the simulated IV in black is quite similar to the data points obtained directly from molecular dynamics. This means that our model predict quite well the current, quantitatively the current. Only at very negative voltage we had some deviation. So what is a possible application of this method? A possible application is to doing molecular dynamic only under certain condition of voltage or ionic concentration, and then predicting using the Markov model to predict the current at different conditions. So we can save computational time. And this is what is shown here. For example, here is the IV, and the red point are the molecular dynamics simulations, while the blue point are estimated using the Markov state model. So we can double the density of the point during the IV by using only half much of the computational power. But we can also do another thing. We can, for example, as shown here, use only the points at higher voltages where it is quite simple to perform molecular dynamics because the current is bigger, you need less time to collect data. And then use the Markov state model to predict the currents at the lower voltages where it is more difficult to perform molecular dynamics. So in conclusion, we have set up a method to build the Markov state model to predict molecular dynamics, to predict the current, the IV relationship. the method has suggested an association-dissociation model for the particular case of SSA, but of course the method can be applied to any kind of channel. And the method can be applied to predict IV under a variety of conditions, much more than that simulated, and also to understand in simple term the permeation mechanism. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Luigi. So we have some time for Q&A. Any question or comment? I'll go first. So you say you also do some ND simulations directly for estimate the current, right? And not need to be too many time and do some average of that, something like that?
Sorry, can you repeat?
I mean the, your MDs, direct MD simulation.
Yeah.
About calculating the current. So you need to do many paths, right? And do the average to get the current, right? Yeah. How long will it take?
Yeah, no, actually that was the system to assess the flux, the combined flux matrix. Uh-huh. Okay. So usually molecular dynamics needs to be quite long. I show you that for a single voltage, for uh-huh. example, for to collect 300 events, yes. they are not so many, uh-huh. you need 30 microseconds of simulation. Uh-huh. I don't know, but I think this means something like 4 months uh-huh. of computational time uh-huh. in a computer, quite powerful computer.
If you do the long MD simulation.
Yeah.
But if you use your method, how long will you reduce to?
The computational time? Uh-huh. I do this with a normal personal computer.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh,
okay. Yeah. This is not... This is really simple from a computational point of view. You can have also you can use also, for example, MATLAB or software to perform operation on matrix. It's very simple.
Yeah, but most of the time,
you don't need time.
But most of the time you spend is on constructing the flux matrix and the Q matrix.
Okay,
right?
The flux matrix is quite simple. Maybe you take some time to build the transition matrix, yes. taking from molecular dynamic data.
Yeah, how long will that take?
So this made Simone, yeah. I don't know exactly. Uh-huh. I think this is quite, maybe in one day you might build it.
Oh, one day, okay. Yeah. Oh, so compare with several months.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Also much more simple.
Okay, and you say this method can extend to a major estimate all the currents through old ion channel as far as they have you can identify those macro state, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so it can be extended to many.
Yeah. Of course, now we only apply to the KCSA, but now there are available data. Not only for potassium, but also for sodium or calcium channels. Mm-hmm. So where the permeation mechanism is completely different. They have fewer binding sites.
Yes.
They are so different. So it would be interesting to apply.
Yeah, especially calcium channel, since the current is very, very small. It's very, very hard to estimate, to measure in the experiment. So this will be very useful.
We have, for example, I think calcium channels have a current that is 10 times smaller than KCSA. Uh-huh.
Yes.
So you will need 10 times more time to collect data.
If you do the long MD.
From molecular dynamics.
Okay, but how about the... we know that also the receptor transporter, the current is also very small because it involves the conformation change and that requires longer time for conformation change.
Well, you mean the getting current?
I mean the receptor or the transporter.
The transporter.
Yeah. Their current is also very small.
Yeah.
So if you use your Markov state model, as far as you can identify their Markov state, then you can apply.
To... Yeah, of course you can apply. I wonder whether you could even obtain 1 point of current for a transporter, because a transporter is 1,000 times smaller than an ion channel. So it's, it would be, I think it's not possible now to obtain even one condition.
I know, yeah. That's so mean, I mean, you if you use your model and if you can identify during the conformation change, they have a Markov state and you can identify that, then you can apply your method. Even the current is very, very small in the experiment, but use your model, you can still can estimate that, right?
Yes, you should have at least all the pathway of the
ion. Yes.
So you might start to from different initial conditions to obtain all the pathway.
If you can identify all the Markov state along the pathway.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, yeah. I see. Okay, very good. Any question or comment?
Yeah.
Can you do the lumping for the reduction from about 100 to 20, right?
Yeah.
Is that equivalent to if you initially define like the to cluster the state like if we don't consider
it's exactly equivalent. We perform some simulations to understand this.
Okay.
You could also start from molecular dynamics and redefine the microstates. It would be the same thing.
Okay. So the transition matrix will be
same. Yeah. So that those equations guarantees that is the same thing. Mm-hmm. But of course, it's much more. Easier from a computational point of view.
Okay, thank you. Okay,
so any more questions or comments
from on site or online? If not, let's send the speaker again.
Thank you.